We will start with this webinar. So, welcome everybody to this fourth Type 1 webinar. This time we will discuss two features of the nodule, the shape and the borders. Both rely on the infiltrative nature of thyroid cancer, primarily of papillary one. First, I will give a short overview about the themes in 20 minutes. Thereafter, seven related cases will be discussed. But before turning to the today's topics, I would like to make a few comments on the November case of the studies. I share my screen. So here we are in November. First, I make some comments about the second case. As you can see, there was a high disagreement about this second question about the dominant intranodular echogenic figure in the left lobe, nodule in the left lobe. So I will show first the video. So this nodule was in question. Can you see this video?
Sure.
Okay.
Yes, we can.
So the question was, what is the dominant intranodular echogenic figure in this nodule? So I think that most of these granules and lines are backwell cystic figures caused by posterior enhancement. Okay, about some granules, it is probable, for example, here, that it can be either microcalcification, this complex structure, but the dominant one, I think this is backwall cystic figures. Most of them are related dorsal to tiny cystic areas, here, 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 and there are both dots, granular forms, and lines. And this is not specific of microcalcification. Any comment?
Please, only.
Please.
Okay.
Okay, so I think that the dominant figure were the back four figures. Does anybody have comment on this case? So around 40% of the participants answered that the back four figures are the dominant type. Cometary artifacts are maybe are present here, but not in a great proportion. Okay, if you have no question, I turn to the third case. Here again, it was a quite great degree of discrepancy. The question was again, what is the dominant kind of intranodular echogenic figure in the right lobe? And here you can see the distribution of answers. So I start with this video. But I beg your pardon. I mute this colleague I mute everybody.
Τώρα τι παίρνεις?
Okay, I have muted everybody. If somebody will have a question, please unmute yourself. So back to this case. So this nodule was the lesion in question. And the question was, what is the dominant intranodular echogenic figure within this nodule? I think that the issue is these large granular dots or granules. In my opinion, these correspond to, most of them correspond to microcalcifications. Some of them is located dorsal to tiny cystic areas, but if you make a thorough analysis, most of them lack this ventral cystic area, and there are not much lines. Okay, there are some echogenic lines here, for example, but these dominant quite large granules, I think these correspond to microcalcifications. Does anybody have comment or question about this? If yes, please unmute yourself. Was it clear?
Did you get the cytology result or the histological result?
This was a papillary cancer. If I turn to the today topic, this nodule has irregular lobulated margins. This was not enlisted among the seven cases. This was the case of the study in November, but it is clearly lobulated margin. I think it is no question about that this nodule has irregular borders, and it proved to be a papillary cancer.
I think these echogenities are bigger than microcalcifications, more than 1 millimeter.
No, I don't think so. I share again this case. Where we are, yes. I will freeze the. So here's a granule, and 1 centimeter is from this line to this line. So this is clearly smaller than 1 millimeter. So this is 1 centimeter. And this is clearly less than 1 millimeter in diameter. So always look at the caliber, right? So this is surely less than 1 millimeter in diameter.
Okay, thank you.
I tried to share another content about this case. Do you think comparison of two cases? Is it? Do you see this comparison of two cases? Okay. So
we can see.
The previously presented two cases are presented. Here is the case with the backwall cystic figures, and here is that with the microcalcification. If you see this case, it is. Why?
We can't see any video.
Please?
We can't see any videos.
Any video, okay.
Videos, we are...
I will try to share... okay. Share content. Yes. Now you can see the video.
Yes, okay.
So, these integral action figures are distributed quite equally all along the nodule. Microcalcification it cannot be distributed in such a regular manner within a nodule. It is more irregular in distribution. So this should raise doubts if we think that these granules would be microcalcifications, this regular distribution. In contrast to this case, it is concentrated in one or several parts of the nodule, these hyperechogenic figures in the right case, which proved to be papillary cancer. So I think these are, most of them are clearly backwall figures. It is not such a degree of certainty that these are microclassifications, but I think that these should be regarded as microclassifications. Any comments or questions about these two cases? Was it clear?
Yes.
Okay. So I turn back, and next time I will make this comparison in the case of the Mann study. So if such degree of discrepancy will be found, then I will present in this webinar these problematic cases. So now I turn to the today's topic. Do you see webinar on intranodular nodule borders? Okay.
Yes, yes, we can see the first.
Okay. Some technical problems. I stop my video and share again. Okay. So I first show the usual warning. Our current topic represents the two opposites regarding the thoughts behind this warning. The shape is the most accurate feature of the nodule with the lowest inter-observer variation. We simply have to measure the largest diameters of a nodule according to the three dimensions. In contrast to nodule shape, the nodule border is the characteristic in which the inter-observer variation is the largest or largest but one. This is the framework of this short presentation. First the borders, thereafter the shape will be discussed. Finally, I talk about their role in thyroid systems and in the most frequent thyroid cancers. Before turning to the discussion of borders, we must be aware of how the border for a regular thyroid nodule looks like. The margins are sharp and follow a normal curve and do not present undulations. An absolutely regular border is a rare finding. In both nodules, we can see indistinctive or blurred parts at the nodule margins. The arrows point to those parts of the nodules where the borders are blurred. Small irregularities on the nodule border should not be regarded as pathological findings. There is a small undulation in the ventral part of the left lesion, while the right nodule has a speculation in its lower pole. These cases illustrate why is it difficult to uniformly interpret of nodule borders. Indeed, the judgment depends on the degree of irregularities, which necessarily shares different opinions. By definition, the borders rely on the outer surface of a single nodule. Outer, single, and nodule. The borders between the cystic and solid part of a mixed nodule are frequently irregular, and the situation is similar in heterogeneous nodules. These inner intranodular irregularities should not be regarded as abnormal. These cases illustrate inner irregularities between the different components of a single nodule. The left is a mixed solid cystic one, while the right is a heterogeneous nodule. These internal irregularities between different parts of the same nodule should not be judged as pathological. Here is a speculation, here is another speculation, but these irregular margins are within the same nodule. Not infrequently, the issue is whether a mass is composed of one or more nodules. Complex nodular structures usually present lobulation, but if this is caused by the presence of multiple nodules next to each other, the lobulation is again not abnormal. Both the right and left mass is composed of multiple nodules, which makes the surface of the mass lobulated. Here we can see lobulation here at the border of these lesions. And this is more evident that this irregularity is probably caused by the multiple nodules next to each other. The left case demonstrates the already mentioned problem, the issue of internal lobulation as well. There is a speculation here and here between the cystic and solid part of the nodule. But this nodule, that here is the mass, this is the mass, here, This is composed of one and another nodule. And in this image is not evident, but the nodule is here, the borders. So this part is within the nodule and not on the outer surface. The focal form of Hashimoto's thyroiditis is characterized by multiple hypoechoic areas, which are not true nodules, but only more active foci of thyroiditis. These discrete lesions have characteristically puzzle-like irregular borders. The left Hashimoto's patient had small hypoechoic discrete areas which presented with irregular borders. These correspond not to true nodules, but to more active foci of the thyroiditis. De Gerwen's thyroiditis is characterized by ill-defined blurred borders which occasionally, as in the case in the right, can also be lobulated or speculated. Here is a speculation, here is a lobulation. The issue in thyroiditis is the origin of the lesion. If this is not a nodule, then we have not to deal with the irregular borders. We have discussed the previous lecture that the nodule borders not infrequently became abnormal after the removal of cystic content. This problem is not mentioned in the literature. The case illustrates this situation. The borders became clearly irregular after the removal of cystic content. However, there is no reason to suppose that this irregularity would be caused by the infiltrative nature of the nodule. Therefore, in the case of a mixed nodule, the borders are best to determine before aspiration. The next consideration is again a definition which is widely accepted by the different guidelines. The term irregular borders has to be maintained only for lobulated or speculated margins. Blurred border is also abnormal, but not irregular. These four cases illustrate the different types of nodule borders. The left upper nodule has sharp regular margins. The left lower has blurred borders here. The two right cases represent irregular borders. The upper nodule has lobulations here and here, while the lower has speculations as well. The difference between lobulation and speculation is the presence of sharp angles. These are curved, these are sharp angles. Both belong to the irregular margins. The next consideration has been already mentioned. This is the lack of biological standard. We have to be aware of the fact that nodule border is most prone to technical problems among all suspicious characteristics. Some of them can be avoided by the appropriate choice of focus and settings. Others are unavoidable. These are, for example, the obesity of the patient or the anatomy of the neck. The final thought draws attention to the fact that the two features discussed today, together with the ultrasound signs of extratidal extension, reflect the invasive growth of the tumor, mainly the papillary cancer. In this figure, I've summarized the classification of nodule borders. So the first distinction is between normal and abnormal borders. The latter can be blurred or irregular. As we can see, blurred borders are not involved in any thyroid systems. An irregular border can be either lobulated or speculated depending on the curved or rectangular presentation of the undulation. I enlist here a third type, which is not mentioned in the literature, so this does not have justification. But this so-called invasive border is very difficult to classify. It is a quite specific feature of papillary cancer. I will present an example here. Here is the tumor core signed with yellow arrows, and in quite a distance there are few microcalcifications. It is very difficult to determine where are the borders of this nodule. It is clearly has blurred borders, but the invasivity is demonstrated by the presence of microcalcifications in a distance from the tumor core. So this is, I name it invasive borders, which is very difficult to enlist among the usual classification system, and this is very specific, this presentation for papillary cancer. Now I turn to the next theme, the shape of the nodule. An irregular shape means that the depth of the nodule exceeds either the width or the length of the nodule. We have to compare the largest diameters of the nodule and not the diameters in a single section. Non-parallel orientation relies also on the infiltrative nature of mainly papillary and to a lesser extent medullary cancer. Let's see two examples. First, I measure the depth, the antero-posterior diameter of the nodule in transverse scan. Then the width was measured also in transverse scan. Now see the longitudinal scan. First the depth signed with white line, and then the length signed with yellow arrows were measured. What we have found? First, see the upper transverse views. It is evident that in the left case, the width, the red arrow, is larger than the depth, white arrow, so the left nodule does not have taller than white shape. In contrast to, the left case shows non-parallel orientation taller than white sign because the depth exceeds the width. Now let's compare the width to the length in the lower longitudinal scans. In both cases, the length, marked with yellow arrows, is larger than the depth, marked with white arrows. So this is how to measure. Although the shape of the nodule is less exposed to inter-observer variations, this site also requires some comments. The anatomy has an impact on the orientation of the nodule. If the lobe itself has non-parallel orientation, then a non-parallel orientation of the nodule, which simply follows the shape of the lobe, should not be regarded as pathological. Occasionally, hard structures, the trachea and the carotid artery, can hinder the normal sideways extension of a nodule. In such cases, the nodule is forced to extend in the antero-posterior direction. There are also some pathological conditions which can also make the shape deceptively irregular. These conditions are enlisted in the table. I will show some examples of non-pathological form of irregular shape. The left nodule, which was located in the upper pore of the lobe, simply follows the anatomy and therefore presents taller than wide sign. So here at this part of the lobe in the upper pore, the lobe itself presented taller than wide shape, so the nodule simply followed this anatomical situation. This patient had three nodules, a larger econormal one, a smaller hypoechoic nodule, and an even smaller in the lower pole of the lobe. This was a minimal hypoechoic lesion. If we watch only the left lower image, we can think that the hypoechoic nodule has taller than long shape. However, the right lower image, this reveals the real situation. This nodule, this hypoechoic one in question, was sandwiched between the two other lesions, which hindered the spread into the normal direction. This case points to two important considerations. First, we have to stick to the definitions. Viewing the left upper image, we could falsely judge the nodule as showing taller than wide sign. However, we have to compare the largest diameters, and the largest width is presented in the right upper image. So this was the real width of the nodule and not this one. So this nodule seemed to have a taller than wide shape, but by definition, we have to measure the width and the depth, not in a single section, but we have to find the largest width and the largest depth, and in this case, the width clearly exceeds the depth. This case demonstrates another issue. the depth clearly exceeds the length in the event of the hyperkick module. So this is the length, and this is the depth in the longitudinal scan. However, this non-parallel orientation, was caused not by the nodule in question, but by the another nodule which hindered the normal extension. So this nodule compressed this hyperkeratic lesion. So this again should not be regarded as pathological finding, or we have to consider the anatomical situation when we judge the real shape of this nodule. Now I discuss the role of these two features in thyroid system. All thyroids enlist these two signs among suspicious characteristics. In the AACE and European thyroids, in the presence of a suspicious characteristic, the nodule should be grouped in the most suspicious category. In the next two thyroids, the prerequisite to classify a nodule as a category 5 lesion, the nodule should be hypoechoic. So in the ATA and Corian thyroids, in these two cases, a nodule presenting irregular shape or border is enlisted into either the most or most but one suspicious subgroup, depending on the echogenicity of the nodule. This table presents the occurrence of these features in the three most frequent subtypes of thyroid cancers. As in all other suspicious characteristics, follicular cancer behaves just the opposite as papillary and medullary cancer. These data, however, make one think. If the aggressive behavior characteristic of cancers is thought to cause irregular shape and borders, how is it possible that these signs are much less common in follicular cancers that are clearly more aggressive than papillary one? To summarize, all classification systems necessarily simplify the reality. We not infrequently meet nodules which do not meet the criteria of one or another classification system regarding the nodule borders. I ask you, don't neglect blurred borders. This is also an important suspicious sign, and all classification systems agree in this fact, but considering the high inter-observer variation, they are not enlisted among the four suspicious characteristics. And although this time we cannot go into details, a warning for upcoming lectures: never forget about follicular cancer, which does not show the usual suspicious characteristics. So this was the short summary of the more detailed pre-recorded lecture and manual presented in the website. Any questions, comments, disagreement? No one? If somebody has, please unmute yourself. Okay, so the question was how to classify a nodule with blurred borders. If we use the thyroid system, it does not matter. But in the everyday practice, when we decide on aspiration cytology, we should consider this fact, and occasionally, despite the suggestion of the thyroids, such nodule with blurred borders should be a candidate of a cytology. But according to the rules, blurred borders are not enlisted in any thyroid system among suspicious characteristics. Are you satisfied with my answer? Because I did not hear quite. Okay? Okay. Other comment or question? No one? Okay. Then we turn to the joint analysis of the seven cases.